When we talk about purpose, it seems very romantic, right? Because you're thinking about the mountaintop. But my gosh, is it difficult, right?
And it was about a month in of following him around that I realized, oh, he earns all this money.
Yeah.
I came to a place where I was over minimizing the work.
There is a, man, a huge resistance to any ounce of, it's about you, it's a performer, you've told that story before, it's not authentic.
We always say don't despise humble beginnings.
Yeah.
But you can get through those humble beginnings because you love it.
My mission is to be a great husband and an extraordinary dad and to help as many people in my local community as possible live a little bit freer, more peaceful life.
My mission is to use my life as an example that is worthy to be called a believer, and then to bring people alongside that and to let people know that they're loved.
My mission is to help people make the most of their money so that they can make the most of their life.
It sounds really cheesy because it's the tagline of my show, and so this sounds really like polished, but I really want people to have a bigger faith in a better relationship with the Lord, but also a better life.
I think the personal mission that I've always had was to be a good husband and a good father. I know my purpose is rooted in just being where I am the best that I can, but really the mission is to see how far and how wide that can go, like how far, how wide we can take that.
I would say the passion that drives my work is that what I talk about works. Again, money is a part of people's lives that they are stressed out, they are freaked out, and I feel like we have the answer. We know this stuff, and if we can give it to people and then help them change their behavior so that they can do it themselves in their everyday lives, we see the freedom that that causes.
I want to talk about people because I think in this journey, this conversation we're having, I don't want people to miss that, and we've talked about, you know, showing up, getting qualified, loving it, all the things, but to not miss that people, people.
Yeah.
Connections.
It's everything.
Is everything.
Everything.
I'm just curious. When you think back, I know I've got a couple people in my mind that I go, I'm not where I am today without them. Mm-hmm. Just curious. Mm-hmm. Who comes to mind? Somebody that believed in you, said something, offered an opportunity, and it changed your trajectory or maybe gave you fuel when you needed it most. Just curious. Who comes to mind?
So Ken, our stories are weirdly intertwined. Before either of us were at Ramsey, I used to work at marketing at a telecom company, and you knew the owner, your buddies with him, and he brought you into a quarterly meeting, and you did a talk for our team on the sweet spot.
I did.
Which is amazing because that's
the worst version I probably ever did, by the way. You had to hear.
It was pretty good
back
in that day. Yeah. And so you came in and I filmed it, that was part of my job, and you said, hey, give me the footage and I'll give you tickets to Catalyst. And in college, I went to Catalyst, and I remember watching you host, and I was like, this guy, I mean, you might as well, you were a hero, because you were interviewing celebrities, Tony Hawk, all these amazing celebrity figures, and I was so inspired by that. And we actually got college credit. I don't know, God bless the South. We got college credit twice. I got 6 credits for going to Catalyst 2 times, and I saw you, and you traded me tickets in exchange for the video, so you could watch the game tape.
I forgot about that.
What year was that, George?
That was 2012.
Wow. We were probably in a tent selling next generation.
Yeah.
Generation Change. Generation
Change. Sign
up for a free t-shirt.
Oh my God.
Being a megaphone.
That's amazing.
Oh, that's cool. I'm on the stage. You're in the audience. They're in a tent.
Just like we always are.
Works
we slept as well.
Here's what's crazy about the relationship part. When I was trying to get this internship, I was just very hungry for it. And I ended up getting on the phone with Jeremy Breland, who leads all of us personalities.
Yep.
And lo and behold, Dr. Breland, his dad, had a really close connection to our school. He was head of the whole music department, and so there was an immediate connection there, proximity principle like you're talking about, with Jeremy, with you, and that really helped get me in the door and created the very first opportunity in that 8-year journey.
That's crazy.
Wow. It's weird. It's all intertwined.
It's so crazy because it's the same. JRB, John Roger Breland.
He's famous.
The man.
I mean, he was... He is the reason why I'm a communicator today. I wouldn't be. I mean, confidently would say that. And then even getting here today, too, like, this is not a pitch for your book, but it's true. I read it on back home, Proximity Principle, on my way home from one of the interviews. And then one portion just really hit on the importance of mentorship. Mm-hmm. And I don't know where I got in my head along the way that, like, I had arrived and I didn't need it. Or I was like, oh, you know, I've been a journalist for this much. And like, no, it's all good. And then I just realized I need to go back to a source that, a well of water that I have not drunk from for quite some time. And so realizing that there are so many other smarter people in the room around me, and I wasn't utilizing that wisdom, and because some, like, you know, Roger Breland, I don't know, he's in his 70s and he's not going to be here for forever. And I realized that was a source that God placed in my life for a strategic time in 2012, 2013, whatever, and now in, you know, at that time, 2020. And so with him also, it was a big piece of me getting here, but for me, just being a communicator in general. He really believed in me.
That's awesome.
So great.
I remember it was 2002 in Memphis. Dad was doing a big event, and we had to, back then we traveled with him as a family.
Oh, wow.
And we had to work the back book tables, and we had to wear these terrible collared shirts tucked into khaki pants.
I love the tuck.
The visual. Oh, that's the tuck.
We have pictures?
I mean, they're adults. But anyways, we had to work the back. That was like our jobs on Saturdays. That's what you got to do. But I remember one guy that was on the team at the time, and I remember watching that because I would watch him. I was just always infatuated by just the whole event space, all of it. And I was in the back and I was watching. And I remember he came over and he just said, "You know, you could do that." And I said, "No." And he just walked away. He said, "Yeah, you can." He walked away. That was it. It was a two.
Wow.
And I can, y'all, when I close my eyes, I can like be back in those little khaki pants and big oversized shirt. And thinking, there's no way, there's no way.
Right.
And then what led to that next summer is was all of that. But I mean, words are powerful, and I know we know that. But when you can just speak that,
you can do that.
You can do that.
Yeah.
And I said, no. And then I would say, Dad obviously played, and he has obviously been a huge, huge. I mean, to have any I think we all know this through studies and all of that. But like the dad role. And I'm just so grateful for that. I mean, it has been, it is encouraging, life-giving, but the words you speak over people, it's huge, it's huge. So yeah, I would say those two have been big. Wow. And then my mentor, Christy, wrote my first talk with me.
I helped you buy suitcases. I'm gonna need some suitcases.
I love that, that's so good.
I don't remember that at all. That's
so cool.
Oh, I remember. It's like, we're allowed to buy suitcases? How do we get this? I don't know, how to buy a suitcase.
I probably, let's be real, didn't have permission to do that. Yeah. Probably just decided, we're gonna need to take care of something.
Apologize on the way back.
There's a real theme in my story, Ken. Ask forgiveness, not permission.
I get it, I like
the takeaway
that.
There.
It's true. So I have two guys that really filled in gaps, because I lost my dad when I was 19. It was really aggressive form of cancer. I lost him in 3 months as a 19-year-old. And I remember my first manager, I was working at a bank, he was the one that really spoke into my life that I had potential. And so he was young too. I mean, he's only a few years ahead of me, but he was a go-getter. He was managing two different banking centers, went to a really big one in downtown San Francisco, then went and started selling real estate. And every move he made, he took me with him, just because he saw potential. So I went from being a teller to being a trainer to being customer service. So I was the highest paid teller in the region because I had just walked with him within a matter of 2 years. And that was just an unforgettable experience of having somebody come alongside me and say, "Hey, I think you could do something more than what you're doing." Really set that up for me professionally and with my potential. But then when I made the transition to work for the church, the associate pastor, he's the brother of the lead and founding pastor, he's the one that spoke into my character. And he saw, yeah, you can do a lot. Like, you've got talents, you've got skills, but your heart sucks. I was like, thanks, man. But he was enough of a friend and cared about me more than what I could do that he was willing to dive into that and walk with me. And that I will never forget. Like, that's the value that I still hold today. It's like, I could continue to grow and be skillful and all stuff, but it doesn't matter if my heart still sucks.
Yeah.
But because he spoke that into me, that's what I focus on way more than anything else.
That's so good.
Yeah.
John?
I got a long list.
I know.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's good.
I obviously go back to my dad, and he was a homicide detective and a SWAT guy. And so I just learned at a really young age, when things are on fire, he would just put his bulletproof vest on and get like a little grin, and he'd get in his car and drive into town. When it's going down, you go in. And then at 42, y'all know this story, my mom wasn't allowed to go to college. And at 42, she took her first community college class. And then the next semester, she took one more. And the next semester, she took one more. And at 57, she graduated her PhD. And then she became a tenured professor at like 63.
Which is so great.
So, but all I'd say is I had a ringside seat to not parents saying, "You can do anything and you need to be brave," but know, somebody's holding a gun to people and I'm going in. Mm-hmm. And then my mom, that, you know, parents say, you can do anything. And I watched my mom just figure it out. Mm-hmm. And yeah. So I had a ringside seat to that. And then, man, I could go to Randall DeMint, Marilyn Fannin, and Jean-Noël Thompson. Jean-Noël was probably the one who said, here's how you honor people, right? And so when you have to terminate somebody, you have to fire somebody, they need to hug you when it's over because you've cared about them for 4 years or 7 years. Yes. And so they know when you arrive at this decision that you didn't take it lightly, you didn't take their family lightly, and you honor them as they leave. Wow. I remember the first time I had to call a parent and tell them that their kid had passed away. I called him first and said, here's what I'm about to say. And he was quiet and he said, John, you know what you're doing and you're gonna honor this family. You're good. And I remember just, that was like a blessing and he was 1,000 miles away from me. Wow. And so having, I mean, and I could just sit here all day and just lay out people in front. But for me, it's always been less about the people in my particular area. Mm. I love being around people who are really good at whatever it is they do and trying to soak up wisdom from people everywhere. Yeah. I just feel like you can pull something from everybody.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah. And I guess the meta is, dude, I'm nothing without the people in my life. Mm. Zero. Nothing.
That's absolutely it.
And gone nowhere. It's silly.
Yeah. I think the thing I just popped into my mind that I want the audience to pay attention to as I hear these stories is as each of you shared your story, you decided to listen.
Yeah.
You didn't just hear the words, you listened.
Mm-hmm. And responded.
You responded.
Yeah.
That's the key. It's a huge investment that people make in us.
Yeah.
And by the way, we need to be looking for opportunities to do that to others as well.
Well, and it's an obligation.
Yeah.
I want to follow up what you said. Jean-Noël let me go once.
Yeah.
And when I worked for him. Yeah. And he ultimately, a couple days later, had me come back.
Right.
But he had a hard thing, and he said, you've put me in a position where this and this, and so on behalf of the team.
Yeah.
And he's still one of the first people I call when I have to make a hard decision.
Right. Yeah.
And so walking alongside somebody isn't always just giving them an opportunity.
Yeah. That's right.
It's telling them the truth.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's holding them accountable. It's having hard conversations. And you can do all those things if people trust that you care about them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'll tell you, my high school speech teacher, Joy Bryant, I got to give her some love because as I sit here today, so grateful to get to do what I love to do, what I was created to do, she is probably the biggest impact on it. Mm-hmm. Because I was a punk as a junior in high school trying out for the play, and it was going to be The Mousetrap by Agatha Christie. I wanted to be the lead character, of course.
Duh.
Duh.
Lead? No.
Seriously. More attention, please. And I remember the day that I tried out for, of course, and she had me read for one other role, the comic relief, the wacky character Christopher Wren. And I remember going, why is she having me do that? And, you know, it doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. And I remember the day she posted the who's going to be in the role there. And I remember walking up and looking at it. I remember going to Detective Sergeant Trotter and waiting to see my name there. And it wasn't there. Mm-hmm. And I ran my finger down and I said, where am I at? And I see Christopher Wren. And I waited till the room cleared out because everybody was gathering there to kind of talk to Mrs. Bryant. It was very exciting. And I waited for her and I was just angry. Mm-hmm. I had been jilted. And I said to her, literally, like, how Christopher Wren?
I'm Ken freaking Coleman.
That's what my attitude and everything else was saying. Absolutely right. And I'll never forget, she said, I know you're upset right now, but you got to trust me. Mm-hmm. She goes, nobody else in the school can play this role the way you can play the role. And we need you to play this role. And if you'll trust me and throw your heart into it, you'll get everything you want out of it, and I guarantee you steal the show with the laughs. I didn't believe her. I came to the first couple rehearsals, bad attitude. I had not memorized my lines. I was holding the production up. I was sticking my butt in the air, as my grandfather used to say. Mm. And she pulled me aside and she said, either you want to do this or not. Do you believe me? Mm-hmm. Do you believe me? Do you believe me that I want the best for you? Mm. And I didn't, but I kind of said I did. I threw my heart into it, and everything that she said would happen, happened. And I'm driving home after that first night, feeling the immature adulation, right? And it was in that moment that I realized we all have a role to play. Mm. And she had enough wisdom to go, I know you want to play this role. That's not your role. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it's people like that that speak stuff into us and we don't even get it at the moment.
Okay, so can I ask you about that?
Yeah, sure.
One of the most powerful moments, I think I was 33, 34, and all the folks I worked with were older than me. And I'll never forget my friend. He's an MIT-trained physics professor who had ideas. I want to be a college president. I want to be a vice president. And we were just having lunch one day, and he said, I think I'm going to always be a world-class number two. I'm always going to be an associate vice president. Mm-hmm. And he said it with a bit of resignation and a bit of peace.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
How do you walk somebody along through, like, I'm never going to sell a million books. I may sell 50,000 and that's my lane. Yeah. And I'm going to cheer for my friend Courtney who sells a million.
Like, that's
how do you walk somebody through that moment when you realize, oh, I'm going to be an awesome bass player, not the lead singer.
Yeah.
Well, and the band has to have a bass player, right?
That's it. I think what I would say to that person is you settling into that unique role is not settling.
Mm.
Because I think that there, you said resignation, but peace.
Yeah.
And I would kind of point out in that moment, hey, do you sense the peace that you're feeling? Just because you have a sense of peace in a not number one role doesn't mean it's not your role. Mm-hmm. We all can't be number one.
Right.
And as it relates to the work that we do, I hope that you guys would punch me in the throat if I forget that it's not about how many books we sell, or how many listeners or downloads or whatever the thing is, the measurement's not it. Mm. It's gotta be about the impact. Mm. The meaning of the work, we talked about earlier, it's loving the work. And if you love the work, I just believe that's your sign. Mm. If you love the work, that's what the creator of the universe, and you can love different types of work. But if you love it, that's a really good sign.
And that is your number one.
It is
you are number one.
You are number one in that role. I think that's really well said.
Yeah.
I think that's the key.
Yeah.
So you can't be tempted by filling someone else's role if someone else's role gets more, you know, I think of the offensive lineman. Like, everything comes back to football for me, right?
Same.
And it's
same.
Like,
sports.
It's sports. Like, the offensive lineman, nobody knows their names.
Yeah.
Right? But there's a lot of offensive linemen in the Hall of Fame. Mm-hmm. And the quarterback, but they're, you know, the quarterback doesn't become great. The quarterback's not a Hall of Famer if they're not blocking for him. Mm. But somebody's got to block. Yeah. Mm. Somebody's got to throw the ball. Somebody's got to run the ball. Somebody's got to catch the ball.
Mm-hmm.
And don't get me started on the holder.
Yeah,
you know, the guy that nobody knows, but if he doesn't handle the snap well, or how about the snapper?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's all he does.
Well, Eddie, you said it before, and you mentioned it, and now you're mentioning it, and I feel as though I had this conversation with myself 2 days ago. It's like, I feel like sometimes I'm always going to be number two. It's like, gosh, it's just not enough. Like, yes, but not enough. And then I thought, and I think about some friends I can list right now, that would say, you are number one. Like, in compared to so many other people who would just trade their life in
that's
a moment
right.
for the opportunity that you, in their eyes, you have number one. There's no number one plus, and you are it. And so I think our perspective on what we get, the opportunity to do, has to be so well balanced in comparing my apples to your apples.
That's
and,
it.
You know, associate versus chief, I don't know. Yeah, senior.
Well, it's like Dave always says, he's a wiener in a steakhouse. He's like, I get to feeling good about myself to hang out with these guys, and they're all billionaires. And I'm like, hey, guys, can I sit at the table? You know what I mean?
Because number one doesn't
always
really
exist. It's always going to be someone better, right?
Yeah. There's going to be that. But the billionaire looks at Dave and goes, I don't know how that guy goes on the air and talks to millions of people.
That's exactly right.
I mean, it's
You know, okay, so we're in a great place. This is fun. I want to talk about the enemies of purpose. And I want to hear your stories.
We never define success, so we always feel like we're failing.
Right.
Yeah. I'm failing as a mom because I didn't spend 100% of my time with them, and I'm failing in business.
What is the deeper fear and doubt on that?
Watch mine are my kids. I don't want to get to the end, and my kids feel like I chose something over them.
What I found is that the critics, they're halfway to being creators. And they're so close because they point the thing out, but they don't actually solve any problems.
Your brain is wired to go with what's familiar. Mm. That's why we stay in abusive relationships.
The goal is not to be perfect in whatever your job or task is. The goal is just to contribute to the customer.
So be humble.
Yeah, so it's not about perfection. It's about, hey, do I make a contribution?